start with that, right? So here is a discussion about networking, and I'm going to start by saying the importance of the anti-networker. What do you mean by that? I don't mean put down the business cards and stop the conversations. I mean change the conversation, which I'm hoping we're going to do, and probably many of you already do this, because I think I'm in a room of like-minded women. But it's not about me, it's about you. And I think about that every time I go to an event or I answer a conversation. It's never about, ooh, how can I make my mind? How can I get them to spend money with me? It's always about, how can I be of service? Because I've learned that when I have that attitude, the customer's gone. I'm fine. I've turned away business. It's about, how can I serve? And when I have that attitude, I actually end up having authentic conversations with people, and then lo and behold, in time, it may not be that day that I meet the person, but in time, that relationship evolves and it takes us both to higher places. So that's the first thing in networking. It's not about me. It's about you. It's about listening to the other person. And so that told me that everything I thought I knew about networking was completely wrong. And I'm so glad that I followed Kathy's presentation, because her emphasis was all about listening to the other person. So if you didn't get to hear her, you may want to chat with her in the pink jacket right over there. But the first thing to do in networking is to listen, to make eye contact, to observe what you can about the other person. You know, what's interesting about this person? Not about what they do for a living, but about who they are, and respond to that. So when I cut you guys loose and say, okay, let's try to put this into action and see how it works for you, I want you to pick one or two or three people in this room that you'd like to talk to, not because of what their company name is. I'm even going to tell you to take off your name tags, because I don't want you to know what they do for a living. I want you to say, I love your hair, or what a cool necklace, or whatever it is, you know, I'm just intrigued. You have the best smile. Something that draws you to the person to get to know them, because that will, in turn, build your business and grow. And the other thing that I have learned is that it's important to do good first, and then to do well, which also informs the conversation. So I meet lots of people who might need my help, they might need PR, they might need some marketing guidance, and maybe not be able to afford it, or maybe they shouldn't spend a ton of money on it. And if it helps to help them, I sometimes do. I always have a pro bono client because I can. And it makes me feel good, and my skills are put to use and help people. And eventually, it does help me to do well. I never actually ask for credit, or I don't want people to know that this campaign is pro bono. I've always come, and that ends up building my business, and I think to myself, well, I have to do more good, because it's not the point of it, you know. I was recently awarded this volunteer of the year designation from United Cerebral Palsy after Detroit, because I did a pro bono campaign for them. They have their annual fundraiser, which is the UCP Upsters, who play against the Detroit Veterans Alumni, and I think it was in March. And they also have a team called the Sled Dogs, which are individuals who skate on sleds and make them happy, and they have to play against the Red Wings Alumni on the sleds, and it's really cool. And they need help with PR, and it's an annual event, so this next one's March 30th, so you know, where does it matter? And a friend was involved and said, you know, we're looking for some help with PR, and she didn't ask me to do a promo, and I said, I'll do it for you. You shouldn't have to pay me from fundraising funds to get the word out. You should be able to use that to help people with cerebral palsy. And I just did it, and I didn't look back, and I did the campaign, and that's great. And then she called me in September and said, okay, we're going to make you our volunteer of the year. I said, no, damn it, I was just doing that to give. I don't want the recognition, so now I have to bring five people to the dinner, because then I can pay for their, you know, dinner and make a donation, because, you know, come on. So when you do good, I mean, all these people that found out about me, which was never my intention, they ended up doing well. And so, but the doing good is the focus. So, so the next thing about this relationship focus is that you kind of have to play a little bit as a psychologist and think about how do you build a relationship, even in business. And I'm going to suggest that there's no difference between a relationship that you might build in business and what you might build with a friend. And the practical matter is the logistics. When you first meet someone that you find interesting, you're never going to call them every day because they're going to think you're crazy. And I don't want to go to coffee with you, you won't meet do that in business either. You have to play that game. You know, I just met a person, sent a quick email to meet you. We only pushed out lunch in a couple of weeks. And it's a dance. And so it's the same type of thing as building a friendship in the business space. You absolutely have to play that game. And then again, when we look at friendships, and I'm sure we all have experiences where either we or somebody else has needed too much from a friendship, and it becomes draining, and you realize, I can't supply this. This person needs to heal herself on her own, or whatever it is. In business, that stuff comes out too. People bring their baggage with them into every realm that they're in. And so we have to remember that in every relationship, and in our business relationships, from within, and I can fulfill myself, I can do my work without needing that other person. It becomes a relationship of equals and of equal respect. So that plays in as well, because our psychology comes up in a lot of places, and well, even business relationships. So that's a couple to keep in mind. Then the next factor is to build relationships that make sense. Not everybody that you meet, in fact, probably about 80% of the people that you encounter probably aren't the ones that you're going to have a synergy with, and that's okay. We meet lots of people, and we go to a lot of places, which is wonderful. It makes the world more open to us, it opens our eyes, and we learn in every situation. But that does not mean that we need to hang on to relationships that don't serve us. And so when you're networking and when you're pursuing business relationships, it's essential to decide which ones make sense in your business capacity and which ones don't. You may know that right away. You may meet someone and say, this is a really interesting person. But you know, we don't have anything in common. I don't need to continue the conversation. That's okay. It's not anything personal. Or you might meet someone and you don't know where it's going to go. You don't know if your businesses will ever serve each other or align or in any way collaborate. So you ride it out and you see where it goes. And if several conversations later, it's apparent that you guys have a great partnership possibility, or this person becomes a customer or whatever, brilliant. If not, it's okay. It's okay to walk away, and having had that interaction, you're better for it. And I think Kathy spoke about this as well in her talk, in different words. Whether you're religious or not, or whatever this means to you, there's got to be a higher purpose for what we're doing. If it's just about the money, it's just about the attention. It's just about building the bottom line. It's never going to go anywhere. And we're always going to be sort of frustrated running in circles, like chasing our tail. So the best entrepreneurs have a higher power, a higher purpose, a calling. Yeah. Something that drives them to do good rather than do well. And that's a question that I ask myself all the time, what am I doing this for? Am I in PR today just so that I can put food on the table? No. I'm happy to say I'm happily remarried, and for the first time ever, I have a second income, which is great. And I could do other things. I could get a job somewhere. I could do so many other things. I choose this path because it feels like a calling. It feels like my purpose. And I think about that every time I take on a new client. I don't just say, oh, I need a client, we need more money. And I'm not a millionaire. I have no goal of ever being a millionaire. I get there, that would be, I understand, okay. But having enough is enough. And so I want to have clients that I can believe in, that I can promote, that I'm so inspired to work with, and be able to bring my staff, and be able to bring myself, and I just know. And at the end of the day, go home, be with my kids, and have a good life. And so, what am I doing this for? If I have a client that makes me crazy, and I see the name on the iPhone, I don't want to answer. I don't want that client anymore, right? There's got to be a reason for doing this. And people say, you have no money, and it's got to mean something. So, what is the goal? And we're still in the shadow of talking about networking. So, how do you build a business that continues to build itself? Well, I'm going to take us back to relationships. Who we know and who we interact with are really important. And just the very act of interacting. And I'm the first to admit that once I go someplace, I'm so happy that I went and I meet people and it's great. But if you ask me an hour before, I would far rather put on my yoga pants and sit on the couch. So I have to get myself to go. And once I do, I say, wow, that door's open. People I get to meet. And what a wonderful experience. was. And that helps to build the business because you have exposure, and you have interactions, and you have those relationships. Those relationships that matter are the ones that grow over time, and where there's a depth of connection, where it's not just a business relationship. You like each other as people, and there are many facets to the relationship that you're looking at, and that's what's going to bring you joy and growth. If you have 3 to 5 of those kinds of relationships, it can make all the difference. And it can be a relationship that starts as a friendship and grows into somehow collaboration in the business world. It can be the other way around. Not that we always want to blur lines, but there are many reasons that we can know someone and many places where we can serve each other. So if you have 3 to 5 of those great relationships, it's going to take you really far. Like I said earlier, relationships in business are the same as friendships, and they require nurturing. The right amount of nurturing, not an everyday thing, but you know, you have to coffee or have lunch, you want to touch in frequently so that you can nurture that relationship and help it to grow. And there should be a sense of genuine inquiry and interest in the other person and then in you. You know, if they're all talking about themselves all the time, probably don't want to help them again, right? So it's got to be that give and take. So whenever I hear somebody say, hey, you got to do this networking thing with me, I sort of bristle and I think, I have 4 kids, I run a business, I do all kinds of things. I don't have a lot of time. So if you want me to go to a networking thing, I don't know. To me, networking is a bad rap, and I think it's the same for a lot of people. There are people who just have lots of success when they network, but there are more people who go, they power the room, they collect a ton of cards, and go home and feel empty. What did I do that for? Where are those relationships going to go? Is anyone going to turn into someone that I need or that they need? And I'll tell you why networking has a bad rap. Because, of course, as in anything, a few bad apples will spoil it for the bunch. But this thing called relationships is a marathon, it's not a race. It's not something that happens the minute you pass a car around the room and then go on to somebody else. That's not what it's about. That's the very beginning, that's the introduction. And so, unfortunately, we see often 3 kinds of networkers that can spoil it for us. So, continuing this whole racing metaphor, there's the sprinter. This person, they've got to go, they're the super networker. They go the distance, but they tire quickly. So they're going to pop in, they're going to spend the first 15, 20 minutes shaking hands, passing out cards, and they're out of it. In, out, done. Barely saw them. There's the 5K runner, who is the professional, consummate networker. Gets as many business cards as possible. There may be a file, there may be a drawer, they're all there. And this person uses LinkedIn like it's going out of style, left you until you're like, is this person where I meet them? You are bludgeoned with information because they'll say, I've got this many questions and I've got this many likes, and you don't want anything to do with that person, right? They think they're doing it right. Then there's the herder. This person is all about themselves. Hi, this is what I do, I need this business, I sell this, do you need it? Okay, it's a hidden agenda or it's an overt agenda, but it's all about that. They really don't care about what you have to offer or about engaging in a relationship that's going to be mutually beneficial. It's just all of that, okay? And that's a turnoff too. So, what's the answer? And this one started too. Can you guys read that? I'm sorry about that. I was going with color. So, anyway. I suggest that we network by anti-networking, okay? So we do it smart. You become a marathon runner, which means I'm in this for the long haul. I'm interested in meeting 2 good people today, and I'll see where that goes over time. And you never know where that's going to take you, because those 2 people may turn into relationships, they may introduce you to people, you just don't know. You know, you may join an organization, but it's not that you're just going to take a plunge. You're going to have an interesting, honest conversation, and you're just going to trust that it's going to lead you somewhere. I would focus on centers of influence. Well, what does that mean? 1 to 2 relationships can open the world for you. If it's somebody who you can learn from, they can introduce you to people, they can take you places, they can open your eyes to a different way of doing business, living life, exercising, whatever it is, that's pretty powerful. So if you find those 1 or 2 people, again, You don't know the difference that you can make. I would suggest that we stop seeing the goal as who we meet when we work hard to collect. And I do have a drawer like that, and I never go through it. So I don't know who's in there. It's not shame. The goal is interviewing someone and carefully listening to hear if they're a member. Is this person a piece of really getting to know me? Am I just getting to know them? Is there something there? And that's how we build relationships that make sense, right? So, then, interactivity is key. You can't do that by sitting there and not doing anything, talking about it, right? You've got to actually try it and see if it works. So you stand out by changing the game. So not just today, but we're going to all try this and see if it works. But next time you go to some kind of, you know, chamber, networking, schnooze hour, try it and see what happens. And it doesn't matter. If you're not after learning 5K, not like a sprinter, that's great. You can smile with compassion and say, I get it. I don't know if you're going to get to hear that great talk at the Matthew Convention, you know. So you change the world by modeling it. When you interact, and you know, we're sharing in a few minutes, don't sell yourself. I don't care what you do for the hour, but who you are. Ignore everybody in the room. Just find two or three. It just looks interesting. You'd like to know a little bit about. Maybe they gave a talk earlier and just seem really authentic. Or there's just something that seems honest about it. I don't know what it is, but there's something that you're curious and you want to take that a little further. And look for the people with whom you can build strong, lasting, mutually beneficial relationships. Okay? And I know this sounds a little touchy-feely again, but if you believe that this will work, it actually will. Okay? So, what are we going to do today? And on the slide, so there you go. This is our speed networking, which is actually not going to be so speedy. Again, find no more than three people who seem interesting to you, and I'm going to guess that you're not going to be able to get to three if you have these kinds of conversations. When you go, and this is going to be funny because we're all trying to do this, and so we're going to see who goes first, but get to know them. You need to want to ask a question instead of supply the answer. You know, I want to know you. And on your table, I have a little handout that has two little girls holding hands. There are some questions at the bottom of those little circles. And choose one of those questions because we won't have a lot of time. But to get to know somebody, again, do not ask what they do for a living or what their company is, because that is secondary. It's who they are. So the options are, what is your favorite way to spend your time? What do you love most about the work you do? Not what you do for a living, but what do you love most about what you do each day? Okay? If you could do anything, what would it be? Or, again, just one of these, where is the most interesting place that you've traveled? And I just want you to ask that one question. I want you to take off your name tag. I want you to ask one of these questions. And I want you to listen. And if it's interesting, prompt the conversation to go a little further. Oh, you went to Bali? Yeah. What did you do in Bali? How'd you get there? How long were you there? Did it change how you look at things? By the way, I went there in March, and so yeah, that's how I'm saying that. But learn a little bit about who this person is, and you can take the card or not take the card. If you want to be really diplomatic and kind, you can, you know, because you may say, this person is so interesting to me, but I don't want to let them know that. It's kind of hurtful. So you can take the card and be diplomatic about it. But, you know, end the conversation with, it was really nice to meet you. No promises of we're going to conquer the world together, but it was really nice to meet you. And then, if it was, and you want to take that conversation further, you'll get in touch with that person after you leave today, and you'll see where it takes you. So what I'm going to say is that we're going to do, how much time do we have? We're going to do 15 minutes, and then I want to come back because I want to hear how it feels, okay? And we'll do a little Q&A. So I'm going to let you loose, and I'm going to tell you when 15 minutes are up, and I'll let you know how it goes, okay? Bye-bye.